Hello friends, you're with the Lonesome Gamer, and today I'm gonna play Chariots of Fire by Richard Burke and Mark Herman from the Great Battles of History series. I have already done a short video series of this before about the Battle of Sumer, and now I will do probably a little longer series about the Battle of Meggido. Okay, so let me give you a short introduction here. Actually, this battle is the first battle we know quite a bit about. And it's interesting to notice that, we've done this Sumerian battle lately, and there are nearly 900 years gone from the Sumerian battle to this battle. So that just shows you basically what time spans happen, how old this Sumerian battle really was. It's amazing that we were able to play this at all, even though it is just, basically guesswork. But that was actually the first one we know a little bit about. And this is now actually a battle where we know lots of details. But it's important to point out that it's all from Egypt writings. So that's possibly not all quite the truth. So in general, it is that the Canaanites, they revolted against the Egypt after the death of Hatshepsut. And, the Egypt obviously didn't want to let that happening, especially because the region that we're talking about here, this era around Megiddo, was probably very important for the foreign trade of Egypt. So therefore, they really wanted to hold this city of Megiddo and, the streets there, the whole area in general. So what happened? Well, there was a coalition between the Canaanites, the Mitanni, and the Syrian kingdoms under the king of Kadesh. And I'm not sure if we actually know his name. I don't think we do. No, I don't think we know the name of this guy. And they were waiting for the Egypt in the mountains around Megiddo. And there were basically two really good roads that led to the mountains. So the forces of the rebels awaited them there, and they split up their forces to control each of these two big roads. So now the pharaoh, Thutmose III, he has sent some scouts, so he knew about the problems awaiting him, and he decided now to take a very small pass through the mountains. And that was a pretty risky undertaking, because in this pass, something like something could have happened to him, like it happened to the Persians from the Spartans in this mountain pass of the Thermopylae. I don't know if the language spelling of that is right, but, it's a Greek name, so anyway. Yeah, so the risk is that there could have been an ambush, and this big force couldn't really spread out, so they could have been really slaughtered in this narrow pass. But his idea was, hey, this is such a bad way, so I assume nobody is awaiting me to take that way. And that's why I'm going to do it. Well, that must be the logic of a successful leader, I guess. At least if it works. And that's exactly what happens. He went through that small way. Nobody was expecting him. And the surprise effect was complete. And he managed to gain an overwhelming victory against the forces of the Canaanites and their allies. Okay, well, and therefore in this battle it's also not exactly balanced. The Egypt have better troops, they have better equipments, and not equipment, but yeah, better troop types basically. And well, they are also numerical superior here. Okay, let's set up the game. Okay, so the battle is set. The yellow troops are the Egyptians. We have here the overall command of the Egyptians, Tutmosis III, as you can see, with a initiative rating of 6, charisma 5. And he's in lead. He's the overall commander and also the wing commander of that specific wing, with this PH marker up here, or this PH marking up here. And this is basically, these guys are now all chariots stacked with runner infantry upon them. So that was a new achievement during that battle, that chariots were combined with simply with men running next to them. And so therefore only a few Egyptian units use that runner infantry. The problem with the runner infantry is they are much slower. They have a 4 at speed, while the chariots, wait a second, that's not true. They have a speed of 6, that's the speed, the right one, while the chariots have a speed of 9. So that's actually a big, it's a disadvantage. So as long as they were as they are kept stacked, the chariots will obviously move slower. Here Tutmosis, he also has the standard. That's important for routed units. And then there is a little bit of shark infantry here behind, and one bow, one light infantry with a self bow. Over here, we have 1st Division, there's the number up here, the 1st Division commanded by Imhotep. These are basically 5 chariot units. Imhotep itself is sitting on one of them. Over here, we see the 2nd Division, commanded by Elana, this one here, also 5 chariot units. And then we see an infantry division, mostly with shocking infantry, commanded by Karis. But there's something special about these 2 divisions, and I'm going to explain later what that is. On the other side, we have now the coalition's forces. We have here the 1st Division. Which contains chariots. And there is the overall commander, Durusha. And we have as a wing commander of the 1st Division, the King of Meggido. And if I'm not mistaken, Durusha, I'm going to check that. Is he also wing commander? I'm not sure if he's also commander of that 1st Division. Let me check that. Oh, man. No. Okay. Then, one thing is important. The facing is, they have to face in the direction of northeast. We can see here the arrow north. So they have to show in the direction of Meggido because they were simply on the way to get there. And there was that surprise when the Egyptians shows up. So they don't face the Egyptians right now. They got to turn around to face them, which is definitely a disadvantage. They are a little bit on a hill, which might give them a slight advantage, though. Here we have, this is the 5th wing, the 5th division of, led by King Ugarit, 5 chariots. And here we have the, this is basically the, let me see. Yeah, we got the Meggido wing. That one is the so-called Meggido wing. We have the Ugarit wing, which is this one here. And then we have the infantry wing. So we can see here, here we could actually choose how we wanted to deploy these guys, how we want to face these guys. And as you can see, they are not facing the enemy, but they're facing these mountains. And the idea is, once they are up the mountains, they might have a better chance to fight back. And actually, I've read, there is a special rule for these guys too. It's the reserves rule. These guys are the Egyptian reserve. So they cannot be activated right from the beginning. You can activate these guys one after another. First the 2nd division, then the 3rd one. By using a momentum chit, you can, you take the momentum and roll against the initiative of the appropriate leader. And if you're successful, so if you roll equal or less than the initiative, the wing is activated. Should Tutmosis be in command range of that leader, we can subtract 1 from the die roll. But basically we want Tutmosis here, I guess. Apart from that, I'm actually now thinking about deploying these units a little different. I think they should all face this direction. I'm not sure though. I mean, the idea is these guys are not activated yet. I might use them to support these. Maybe I could either move through here and try to come from the side. That's maybe an even better idea. So I think I'm gonna go this way. Yeah, that's a good idea, I guess. Just like that. And move in this direction here. And these guys, they all want to try to run onto that hill. Maybe they then get a chance to defend that Meggido division, or at least to support them. And a high ground might be a better chance anyway. In addition, we have here the city of Meggido. Nobody's allowed to enter that through a gate or so. These two guys here are the city garrison. They cannot move out of the city, but they can shoot from the walls. The city is the standard of the rebels. So if a unit should rout but not be eliminated, it will simply move into the city, but it is out of the game. It won't return. There is no way to rally or something. This guy will simply move into Meggido, and that's it. But it doesn't count there for the purposes of route points. What's the goal of the game? Well, if if from the rebels 60 rout points are eliminated, then Egypt wins, or if all units are either eliminated or in Meggido. So if there is no unit on the map to fight, you also win, obviously. If 80 rout points should be eliminated from Egypt, then the rebels win. Or if 45 chariot units rout point should be eliminated or routed. So they don't have to be killed, these chariot rout points. They just have to be either eliminated or routed. I'm not absolutely sure what happens if you rally, because then you would kind of regain these units. I think you can do that. Lost more than 45 rout points in eliminated or routed chariot units. Maybe not. Hard to tell. I'm really not sure, actually. Okay, I think what I'm gonna do is, if these guys, if the chariots once routed, they count as route points. And if they then are rallied, they won't come. I will not increase the route point number again. So maybe that's a slight advantage for the rebels. But that's how I read the rules. I'm not sure here. I think that's not really clear. But it's probably kind of unlikely that this will happen anyway. Okay, so yeah, I guess we can start the battle now. So for the real basic rules, please check out my Sumer introduction scenario. You can find that on YouTube or on lonesomegamer.com. And here I'm going to only cover now the additional rules with the chariot, their special maneuvers. So again, we start with the initiative roll now, and we roll first for Tutmosis. He has an initiative value of 6. Wow, that's a 12. And now this other guy, do whatever. Oh man, it's again this shit. Durusha. Okay, at least no abbreviation this time. Wow, okay, he starts. So he can choose now a... He can choose now a wing. And he's gonna take wing 1. That gives him the option to turn his units around and maybe actually do a first hit against these guys. Okay, well, actually I reconsidered that. I've chosen now wing 5. It's this wing over here. The idea is that if I'm lucky, these guys will be bound here as a reserve for a while. So I'm thinking about moving these chariots this way here so that I can then attack this wing, this pharaoh wing, from the flank. That might be an option. So, well, let's move these guys. That's, let's see, they have a speed of 9. That's a lot. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay. So they move basically here. I think I'm gonna actually do it that way. Okay, cool. These guys are not so bad here. They have the high ground, and although they're facing in this direction here of Megiddo and not in the direction of the Egyptians, they can fire back. They have a, well, they, their fire angle is a complete circle basically. So maybe that's not such a big problem for them. Okay, then we have the momentum. Okay. Well, I'm a little bit wondering if I should trump or should try to trump as the Egyptian player. My chances are very high. I have a 6, so I might actually consider doing this. On the other hand, there's also a good chance that the other guy is not successful in doing this momentum roll. So I think I'm not gonna trump right now. Ah, he made it. So now I gotta choose. Well, actually, I should have chosen before who's gonna move a second time. Well, I mean, I could actually go with these guys again. Well, that's now interesting. The Egypt player might end up in some trouble now because they are kind of enclosed maybe by these forces here. Wow. I think I'm going to try that. I'm going to move with these guys a second time. This cohesion hits you take if you move a second time in a turn. That's something that only happens to shock infantry or heavy infantry. So the chariots can move a second time without any problems. I'm just wondering, there might be a problem with the fact that... Just a minute. Okay, so again, things are a little more complex now. First of all, I actually should have set... which wing rolls first, because I have if I do the momentum thing, because if I want to activate this guy, for example, this wing, I have to move against the wing leader's capability rating, which is, I think, the one. Yeah, exactly. It's this one, the two here with King Ugarit. So that's gonna be a tough one. Now, in addition, this guy has to be in command range of this guy, of the overall commander, which is in this case, Durusha. Now the problem I see, and that's another point here, Durusha himself seems to be no wing commander. So from what I understand it now, because the wing commander of this map, Big Wing here, is actually the King of Meggido, we always have to roll against these against these ratings here, against these capability ratings, which are always a two, also here with this guy, the King of Canaan. So that makes things much harder, and the momentum is not that much worth anymore. Okay, so basically, I'm going to do the following. I rolled a zero. I mean, that is good enough to activate this guy. This is the only option now I have. And even if I had chosen, they all have the same capability rating, so I guess it makes no difference in this case. So what's happening now is that these guys will attack, and I'm not absolutely sure though. Well, they might attack that wing here with a few of these. Problem then is that this is ridiculous. That's really hard. I mean, these suckers are not even in command because he is the commander. He only has a command range of 6. So that means that these guys are no longer in command. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Only that wing is in command. That looks weird. Okay, it's indeed exactly like I said. So that means now actually that these guys are out of command. So to indicate that, we can flip these units on the other side. The funny thing is that this guy is also out of command. That's really weird. And so that means now that, yeah, well, they're out of command.
Man, this is weird.
Okay, so I guess what I'm gonna do right now is... I think I'm gonna take these guys and try to start shooting these chariots here. Let's see. Yeah. Okay. So I'm gonna get 8 or 9 spaces here, and I'm gonna... That's the first one. To shift the facing. 1, so it's 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And now I'm gonna shoot at this guy here. Okay, so let's check again. We have here a composite bow. That's indicated by the C here. And the enemy is also has a C. They both have composite bows. So we have a composite bow here against a chariot in this case. So that's +1. And composite bow here. We are 2 hexes away. So we want to roll a 0 to 4. But we have also moved. So we have a +2 modifier. Oh man, that sucks. Pretty unlikely that we can do it, but we can try it anyway. Might be a pretty stupid idea in the end. Well, wow, that was a hit, actually. Cool. Yeah, it's single hit. Pretty awesome. Now, there is a reaction fire of this guy, a return fire. And he only has a +1 modifier, simply because... he isn't moving. Okay, that was a no hit. So that means that now... Well... This guy takes a hit. Pretty cool. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then we change the facing, so we have 6, 7, 8, and I'm gonna change the facing again, I guess. Okay, what happens now is there is a chance that the chariot will actually turn over. And to check that, we have a chariot turnover table. Just searching, here we go. So here we have a type chariot 2, and we used, I think, 8 or 9 movement points. So we got to roll a die, and on a 7 to 9, some chariots of this unit turned over, and we will take a cohesion hit. Yeah, okay. So that was bad luck. Oh, come on. So it kind of seems that the attacker has definitely a greater risk, but on the other side, we want to do something here. So... I think I'm going to try the same thing with this guy. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I'm going to shoot. Okay, so let's see. Wow, that's not bad actually. So that's another hit for this guy. Okay. And then we have the return fire. Shit. Okay, that was also a hit. That's. And then we will actually also change facing. And then we gotta roll again on this turnover table. And again we take a hit. Shit. So this whole maneuver kind of sucks. To be honest, I really find it hard to make a successful attack in this game. Sometimes I'm under the impression that it makes simply more sense to do nothing. Basically, it would be the best for both units simply to do nothing, because whoever does the first thing will probably have a disadvantage here. I mean, you can't see that here clearly. It's a pretty bad situation for me. But it might change, at least I hope so. I think I'm gonna do another thing like that, and then maybe position some other... Oh, well, we'll see about that. I'm gonna do another attack like this. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7... Eight, nine, and I'm gonna take a shot. That's a miss. Then we have the return fire. That's also a miss. And the turnover roll. And that nothing happened. Okay. I wonder if I should do the same thing with this guy. Maybe I should place him somewhere in the middle so I can try to... We have a command range of 6. Yes, yeah, so I think I'm going to try to... 1, 2, 3... 3, 4, 5, 6... Gotta go one more step, I think. Okay, so that was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, actually. And... Yeah, then I'm gonna move some of the others too. By the way, there is a chance we take some damage because of this turnover. So if we roll a 9, that's not happening with this guy. Pretty sure it's also not happening with this guy, but you have to try. Okay, he's also fine. And then I'm gonna 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, they're both fine. And, well... Boy. Okay, so now I ended up like this. I'm actually thinking about placing this guy somewhere else. He has a movement allowance of 9. So, maybe not, maybe a little bit behind or something. Damn it. What about here? That's fine. Yeah, that's cool. I think that's okay now. So he controls now all these wings here, that one, these guys. And these guys are out of command. Well, we see. We'll see what happens now. Maybe it's a little risky, but if the Egyptians really try to enter here, attack these guys, then they have the risk that they will be enclosed by these wings here. We'll see about that. It's going to be interesting. Okay. Let's come to the next chit. Now this is division one of the Egyptians. Man, that's really hard to tell. Okay, so I'm actually thinking about moving this guy a little bit out of the battle zone here. So, one, two, three, four, five, six, and let's say a seven. Okay, actually I made a mistake. I rolled only once for each facing change these guys did. I should have done that for every time they change facing on this chariot turnover table. I'm going to do this from now on. So this guy now changed facing, I think, basically two times. Man, this is also complicated. Or is it important? Man. So, I think I'm going to protect this guy by moving here. Something went wrong with the recording here. I forgot to press a button. I hope I'm not completely wrong. So basically, these guys showed up here now. Try to shoot here. Nothing happened. Nobody managed to do a hit. And I don't know. I gotta be honest here. I have no idea how to do a reasonable attack. I find it extremely tough to do. And as I said, I don't see an advantage for the attacker. And that is a problem somehow. Maybe it would have been a better idea to come closer. But I don't know. I mean, probably not. In the end, the other guy can do the return fire, and we might even see an entry fire from another unit, an entry reaction. It's these return fires, these reaction fires, which, I don't know, I mean, they really suck, you know? They make this game kind of weird, because if you attack, you have the disadvantage. And I'm not sure if that's what you want to do. What that's intended, basically. Okay, we have now here the Pharaoh activation marker. And, well, Let's see what they can do. They have now the advantage, at least these guys have the advantage with the runner infantry, that they are pretty good in shock combat. So we might consider moving forward only a little bit. Maybe the whole wing a little bit on that direction, but that would then leave... You know, that's exactly the point, you know? If we move forward, it leaves room for the other guys. Man. Okay, now here's the thing. It seems to me... like these guys might have a problem. So let's see, they might, because they can now be attacked by the chariots with the runner infantry. And I'm pretty sure they have a pretty big advantage here. So that's... where's this... chariot? There was something in the errata that might have been that these guys actually... Yeah, exactly. They have an attacker superiority. So that's pretty cool. That's what we're gonna do then. Okay, let's see, we could do an attack on these guys here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, actually. And we see a reaction fire. Yeah, and that's kind of dangerous now. Oh, let's see what we got. Oh boy, we have here, again, the composite bow against, that's a plus one. But it's only one hex, and they are higher. If the unit fires at a target unit on a lower elevation at a range of 2 hexes or more, well, that's not the case. Well, but here's the thing. I wonder if these guys are now allowed to make an orderly withdrawal, because... these guys only have a range of 6. That's possible. Okay, so it's actually possible. This guy can now make an orderly withdrawal when that unit entered a hex 2 spaces away from him. In addition, he can make an orderly withdrawal reaction fire. So he can now... I'm really no fan of these reaction fires. I think they are extremely strong and they make an attack very, very unattractive. So we have here now the... let me see. Oh man. So what we want to do is, we want to attack. We can actually choose, I think, at which of these 2 units to fire. And we're gonna fire at the runner infantry with the composite bow. So it's this line here. So it's a -2 bonus, which is amazing. In addition, we are on a higher elevation. That means we can subtract another one. Now that's an interesting question. Will they move or not? Pew. Hard to tell. Well, it says here, all retire withdrawal reaction fire at units moving away from the unit. What? All retire withdrawal reaction fire at units moving away from the unit, affecting the defensive movement. What the fuck? Well, I say these guys are moving away. I'm not sure, but it makes more sense to me. So they can move now two spaces away. And no, that's actually, that's also not true. They can move further. They can move the difference. This has a 6. This has a movement allowance of 3. So they can move 3 spaces away, but they don't want to do that. So they end up, well, actually they only want to move here. Question is, can they choose how far they want to go away? I think so. This is pretty ridiculous. There's so much to take care of. Oh man. Up to a number, yeah. Okay. And now we can roll a die for this fire. So let's see, it's a 7 is probably not enough. Though they get a -2 modifier and a -1 modifier, but that's a +1 again with the movement. So it's a -2 modifier overall. 2 hexes. So no hit here. Okay. Oh boy. Okay, now, what about this guy? In theory, he could have, well, can more units withdraw? I don't know. Oh boy. Anyway, now this guy comes closer here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And now actually this sucker is withdrawing. And chariots can, by the way, automatically withdraw. Other units have to make a TQ check. Chariots always do a successful withdraw, and they're gonna roll if they hit, and that's no hit. So this guy can move up to 3 points, so they can, well, I think they also end up here. That allows them then to fire from a safe distance onto this guy. Maybe that's a good idea. And then this guy can come closer now actually to him, and that allows him now this entry reaction fire. Okay, that's a 5. Pretty sure that's a hit. Okay, so we got a -2 again against the runner infantry, a -1. So that's a -3. Yeah, that's obviously a hit. The question is only, is it 1 or 2 hits? That's 1 hit. No, it's 1 hit. Okay. So that means that the infantry now takes a hit. I know this all takes very long, but as you can see, it's pretty complicated. So now these guys are coming closer. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6. And now these guys cannot withdraw because there are actually units behind them. In general, they could. Yeah, that's the thing, you know. I mean, they could move. You can move through other units, but it costs you an additional movement point. So they would have moved. They would use 2 movement points to enter that hex. And then they cannot leave that hex again because there is a hill. So that would cost them another movement point, another additional movement points. So they would have needed 4 movement points to enter to that space. But the difference is only 3. So they cannot do this action. Okay, so now we see the entry reaction fire. Oh man, that's a hit, and that's a very good hit. These are actually 2 points. Wow. Okay, now let's see. We have also this runner infantry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Same thing. Entry reaction fire. That's a 3 then. That's a single hit. Okay, then I think I'm going to move the whole line now a little more forward here. 1, 2, 3, 4. On the other hand, yeah, I think that's fine. 1, 2, 3. Four. Nay. Hard to tell. Let's move them here. I mean, there is now obviously a risk that we might get attacked here from the flank by these suckers. But you know, these are chariots here, they can fire back. These guys, there are chariots underneath, so it's not so terribly bad. And maybe this guy should turn in this direction. Well, fine then. Then we're gonna see some shock combat here. And, well, we gotta do a TQ roll for this guy, I assume. And that's a 3, so he's fine. Then we're gonna do a TQ roll for the other one. That's also fine. And now we're going to start with the shock combat action. And let me see. Well, I guess this sucker... No. This guy here will take... We'll have to fight these two. And this guy will fight this guy. So let's find out now. Okay, as we found out from the Arata, they have a superiority, the attackers. That means, what does that mean? I'm pretty sure it simply means that you double the hits. I'm pretty sure that's what happens. Ah, yeah, exactly. You double the defender hits. Okay, then we are on the Clash of Arm charts. Five. Okay. That's not so great. And then we get to roll a die. We are on a low elevation, which isn't so good, but we have a numerical advantage. And these don't count as 4 units, but they only count as a single unit in shock combat. So we have 1 unit and 2 units against this guy here. That means we can shift now to left. So that means again that we go from 5 to 7. And we are lower. All defenders on higher terrain level than attackers. Fuck. Now that brings us two left again. Shit. Okay, so we're back at five here. Okay, let's do it. Oh, fuck that. That was bad. So, it's... Okay, three hits for me. But four hits for the defender. Because we double his hits. So that's a problem for him now. Okay, well, actually, I made a simply completely stupid mistake. And I'm going to change that because it's just such a bad idea. What I'm going to do is I'm going to leave. Shit. I'm going to leave that chariot one space behind. It makes absolutely no sense to take this guy into the battle because the runner infantry alone is much stronger if it comes to shock combat. So what we're going to do is we're going to do this combat again. It simply makes no sense otherwise. So yeah, okay, let's do this attack once again, because now we have... Okay, right there is no superiority, but we have a numerical advantage. We have here runner infantry versus chariot is 9. Now that's a big difference. We have a numerical advantage. That means we go to 11, and then because of the high elevation, we go back to 9. And now we're going to roll again, and we see what's happening. Now that's a 0. That's not much better, actually. Holy shit. So that's 3 hits for the attacker, 1 for the defender. Wow, that was bad. But anyway, I think that makes more sense. This sucker is down to 4? I think that's not correct, is it? No, I think he was only at 2 or something? Shit, I don't remember now. I think he should now be actually at 3. But I'm gonna check that. So, okay, fine. And these guys take 3 each. Not each, but they can divide these. Okay, I forgot something else. When these two suckers arrived, this guy could have actually made a reaction facing change. And that's what they want to do, because otherwise this guy would have attacked from the flank, which would give him a combat superiority, and we don't want that. Now here's the thing, he has now already 2 points, so we're gonna kill this guy and give him 2 more points, and we give him only 1 point. What does that mean? Well, it means that this guy has to move into this hex now, and there he'll get a warm welcome from the chariots. So it's kind of a problem. Although I'm not absolutely sure if you move into a hex if you're still engaged with another unit. This is all quite complicated. Now this unit routes, what we're doing first is we roll a die and see how bad it is. That's a 4, so actually it stays in the game, and we're gonna place it next to the standard somewhere. So right here. And now first we're gonna do this battle here. So that means we are at column number 9. Then we gotta go to left, which brings us to column number 7, I guess. And then we're going to roll a die. This time it's a little better. So that's 2 hits for each unit. Okay. This disadvantage is really massive if you do an attack from below. Okay. So what happens now, if you are at a point where you are 1 below automatic rout, as this guy is, you have to make a TQ check, and he made it. Now what does that mean? Well, it means that he actually gains a point back. Because he doesn't run away. So he's now at 2. Oh boy. And then, yeah, that's another question. Does this guy have to advance in here or not? No, that's actually not the case. And the reason for that is this applies only for attacking units, not for defending units. So this guy won't move in there. Okay, wow, that was pretty complex. What we're gonna do now is we're gonna finish this video here. I think it's long enough. And we're gonna do the rest of the turn in the next video. This is really a tough game, actually. And now with all the chariots, things are getting more and more complex. And I got this impression, but that's usually a good sign, that you know, the deeper you get into a game, the more details you see, and the harder it gets to really try to play the game without too many mistakes. So in a way, it seems to me like, okay, you know, I'm at that point where I'm trying to, where I understand the basic concepts, but I'm now fiddling with the details. And that's kind of frustrating, but on the other hand, you know, if you do it a few times, you understand how this works. Okay. Well, hope to see you on the next video or on lonesomegamer.com. Bye.